فؤادك الأيام فتى.
The second wasila is called wasail tufzi ila al-maqasid nadiran. It is means that will make you reach your objectives, but not always. It's rarely it does. This one, the ulama, they say, فَهَذَا لَا تَأْخُذْ حُكْمَ الْمَقْصُودِ. Rarely it does. It's rare that it falls and it does the objective. This one, the ulama, they said, فَهَذِي لَا تَأْخُذْ حُكْمَ الْمَقْصُودِ بِالِاتِّفَاقِ. They said it does not take the ruling of what? This one does not take the ruling of the objective. And that's a consensus. It's a tifaq, it's agreed upon. Because why? النَّادِرُ فِي الْغَالِبِ لَا تَلْتَفِتُ إِلَيْهِ شَرِيعَةِ. The sharia does not, majority of the times, it doesn't give looks towards something that's rare. Doesn't give it. Example would be for here right now. If a person says, نَمْنَعُ الزَّرَاعَةِ الْعَنَبِ. We will stop planting grapes. We'll stop it. Why? لَأَلَّا يُتَّخَذَ مِنْهُ الْخَمْرِ. So alcohol is not made out of it. So alcohol is what? So alcohol is not made out of it. قيل, it would be said to him, هذه وسيلة تفضي إلى هذا المحرم نادرا. That which you're stopping right now, which is, that means of stopping, it will what? It will rarely make a person reach an objective. It's rare. فحينئذ لا يلتفت إلى كونها وسيلة إليه. So we don't really give that observation to it. And we don't say that this is a وسيلة بحكم المقصود هنا لندرة اتخاذ هذه الوسيلة هذا الأمر وسيلة لهذا المقصود. نعم. The third one is وسائل مفضية إلى المقصود غالبا. It is a وسيلة that makes you reach your objective a lot of the times. A lot of the times. غالبا, majority of the times. وهذه مسألة. This مسألة falls under the حجية سد الذرائع. This one falls under the proof regarding closing off the door of what? Something that's going to lead to haram. So the question that arises here is, does it take the ruling of its objective? Because it does it a lot. اختلف الفقهاء فيها. The فقهاء, they disputed one another on this issue. And the evidence for this is what? Example for this one is what? Selling grapes. To what? To factories who make alcohol. Or selling weapons at times when there are trials and tribulations between the Muslims, between one another. The Zahiriyya and some of the Shafi'iyya and some of the Hanafiyya, they took إلى أنه لا تسد الضرائع حينئذ. They took the view that it is not. ولا يحرم عليها بالتحريم, and no one can make it haram. ولا مانع من بيع العنب في هذه الحالة, and they said it's no problem, you can sell the عنب, the grapes. And واستدلوا على ذلك, and the evidence that they used that بأن الأصل في هذه الأفعال الجواز والحل, the original essence was that it was permissible. And Allah تبارك وتعالى says in the Quran, فَإِنْ تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. Allah also says, وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. That's their view. The second view, the second speech, or the second view, they said, فِي الْمَسْأَلَةِ بِأَنَّهُ يُحْكَمُ فِي هَذِهِ الْوَسَائِلِ بِحُكْمِ مَقَاصِدِهَا. It takes the rulings of its objectives. وَيُحْكَمْ عَلَى الْوَسَائِلِ الْمُفْضِيَةِ إِلَى الْفَسَادِ غَالِمًا بِالتَّحْرِيمِ. Because the majority of the times it leads to this, they said the ruling is haram. And the evidence that they used on this issue is, قَدْ سَدَّ الذَّرَائِعَ الْمُفْضِيَةِ إِلَى الْفَسَادِ غَالِبًا. That the Qur'an, when it's observed, it closed and it blocked many doors of things that lead to harm, majority of the time, not necessarily all the time. غالبا في كثير من المواضع. Like Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تَصُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَصُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Do not insult those people who call unto other than Allah, because what's going to happen? They're going to insult Allah based on ignorance from themselves. So Allah prohibited what? The insulting of the idols of the mushrikeen. Why? Because it will lead to, لأنه يفضي إلى سب الله, it will lead to Allah being insulted. And Allah تبارك وتعالى, him to be insulted is haram. So they said, فَمَا أَفْضَى إِلَى الْمُحَرَّمِ يَكُونُ مُحَرَّمًا. So anything that leads to haram becomes haram. And they also used فِي سَدِّ الذَّرَائِعِ زِيَادَةِ التَّمَسُّكُ بِالنُّصُوصِ. Other examples from the issue of سَدُّ الذَّرَائِعِ, this issue of blocking and stopping some a means that will lead to what? نعم. We understood that now, inshallah ta'ala. And it seems that the second view is stronger, wallahu a'lam. The second view, which is the view of the majumhur, and inshallah ta'ala, huwa aqwa wa ula. They're stronger and they're more befitting, inshallah ta'ala. We spoke about wasail and we spoke about maqasid. We now need to speak about zawa'id. Zawa'id are the things that are, they complete something. They complete it. فإنها في أصل الثواب وأما بالنسبة لزوائد والأمور المتممة things are زوائد and are complete فإنها في أصل الثواب والعقاب تأخذ حكم ما هي متممة له that the أصل is that the reward and the punishment is taken by the ruling which it completes it takes فالراجح من المسجد إلى البيت فالراجع من المسجد إلى البيت يكون مثابا على هذا الفعل ولكن في التحريم هل الأمور المتممة للمحرم تأخذ حكمه The one who walks from the masjid The one who walks from the masjid Who goes towards his house Does he get a reward for it? Because this is an additional thing زيادة It's not a وسيلة It is not a مقصد It's not an objective He's just coming back It's the additional thing Yes it In terms of reward he gets a reward for it But the question is, هل الأمور المتممة للمحرم تأخذ حكمه؟ But what about if the issue, the متممة, is هل الأمور المتممة للمحرم؟ It completes the محرم. Does it take its ruling? We say this is of two types. This is of two types. The first one is أمور المتممة للمحرم من جنسه. That it is completing a haram in its essence. This one, it takes its ruling and it's a sin. The second one is متممات للتخلص من الحرام. It completes it to get rid of the haram. فهذه لا تأخذ حكمه. This one doesn't take its ruling. And an example for this is المحرم إذا تذكر أن على بدنه مخيطا فإنه ينزع المخيط فهذا النزع للتخلص من المحرم وهناك مسائل يقع التردد فيها هل هي من متممات الحرام التي من جنسه أو من متممات الحرام التي يكون للتخلص منها The man he gets rid of what? He gets rid of something that completes like a thread he gets rid of it that falls on his clothing he pulls it off Is this him getting rid of it? A thread Because in ihram, what are you not allowed to do? You're not allowed to take your beard. You're not allowed to. But the thread is just an additional part of the clothing. نعم. فهذه لا تأخذ حكمة. This one doesn't take its ruling. It doesn't take its ruling. And there are other masail which the scholars dispute one another. Is it from the mutammimat al-haram? Or is it from its jinns? Or is it from the mutammimat التي تكون للتخلص منها? For example, a man who had intimacy with his wife in the month of Ramadan, daytime. نعم. فأذن المؤذن فنزع. من كان يجامع زوجته في رمضان في ليلة. A man who is having intimacy with his wife in the month of Ramadan, nighttime he's having with it. And then the mu'adhin, then the adhan, and so he pulled back. فهل النزع من جنس الوط? For him to pull back, is it from pulling back from the jins of the wat, the intimacy? So based on that, فيجب عليه الكفارة ويبطل صيامه, and his fasting becomes what? Impermissible and incorrect. And then a kafara is placed on him because he becomes obligatory on him. Or do we say it is a naz'u lit-takhallusi min al-wat'i? Does it take the second form that we mentioned? And it's based on that argument, then there's not going to be on him any kafara, and there's not going to be on him any fasting. So the tasawwur of this issue is a mas'ala which is khilafiyyah. Here is, the khilafiyyah is tahqiqul manat al-mas'ala. And inshallah, the issue of tahqiqul manat al-mas'ala, tanqihul manat al-mas'ala, takhriju manat al-mas'ala, all three of them will take inshallah ta'ala in the upcoming points inshallah ta'ala. What's the time? The author, rahimahullah, AbdulRahman ibn Nasir al-Su'di, rahimahullah, he said, وَالْخَطَأُ الْإِكْرَاهُ وَالنِّسْيَانُ أَسْقَطَهُ مَعْبُودُنَا الرَّحْمَانُ لَكِنْ مَعَ الْإِئْتِلَافِ يَثْبُتُ الْبَدَلُ وَيَنْتَفِي التَّاثِيمُ عَنْهُ وَالزَّلَلُ. The author says, وَالْخَطَأُ. خَطَأ, two meanings are met by it. When we say خَطَأ, يُرَادُ بِهِ مَعْنَيَانُ. Two meanings are met by خَطَأ. The first meaning is ضِدُّ الصَّوَابُ. The opposite to what? Sawab. It's the opposite to say correct. As Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he said about Ikhwatu Yusuf alayhim as-salam wa alayhim wa ala nabiyyina alayhim wa ala nabiyyina sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Ya abana astaghfir lana dhunubana inna kunna khati'in. Kunna khati'in here means what? Ala khilafi as-sawab. We were opposite to the correctness. وَاسْمُ الْفَاعِلُ مِنْ هَذَا الْمَعْنَى خَاطِئِ. So خَطَأ, the ism of fa'il of it is, in its meaning, خَاطِئ. The second one is what? عَدَمُ الْقَصْدِ لِلْفِعْلِ. The second meaning that it carries is when you don't intend to do an action. For example, you say, أَخْطَأَ فُلَانٌ. Fulan, he did a خَطَأ. It means, أنه لم يقصد الفعل. He didn't intend the action, or he didn't intend this matter. As Allah said in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ أَن يَقْتُلَ مُؤْمِنًا إِلَّا خَطَأً. خَطَأ هي اسم فاعل منه مخطئ. خَطَأً واسم الفاعل منه مخطئ. The author, رحمه الله تعالى, he means the second meaning, not the first meaning. He doesn't mean ضد الصواب. He means عدم القصد للفعل. وَالْخَطَأُ, a person who does something unintentionally, لَا يَلْحَقُ بِهِ الْإِثْمُ, a sin will not be placed on him. If he didn't intend to do something, a sin will not be placed on him. بِدَلَالَةِ عَدَدٍ مِنُ النُّصُوصِ, based on a lot of evidences. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِن نَسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. Oh Allah, don't hold us account for something we have forgotten, or something that we did unintentionally by mistake. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the hadith narrated in Sahih Muslim, Allah replied by saying, قَدْ فَعَلْتُ, I have done that for you. Meaning, I will not hold you account for something you have done out of forgetfulness, and I will not also hold you account for something you do unintentionally. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said in the ayah, وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ فِي مَا أَخْطَأْتُمْ بِهِ وَلَكِنْ مَا تَعَمَّدَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. وَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ فِي مَا أَخْطَأْتُمْ بِهِ. There is no harm or blame on you in something you have done unintentionally. وَلَكِنْ مَا تَعَمَّدَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. But whatever your heart done it intentionally is what you held account for. Also the hadith in the Prophet ﷺ, where he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَجَاوَزَ لِي عَنْ أُمَّتِي أَلْخَطَأْ وَالنِّسْيَانِ وَمَا اسْتُكْرِهُ عَلَيْهِ. Allah تبارك وتعالى, he has forgiven my ummah, the Prophet said, their khata, that which they do unintentionally, nisyan, something they do forget from out of forgetfulness, and وَمَا اسْتُكْرِهُ عَلَيْهِ, and that which they are burdened into doing, they are put under duress and they do it. This hadith, the scholars, they disputed its authenticity. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal held the view that this hadith is weak. And other than Imam Ahmad, they strengthened this hadith. They what? They strengthened this hadith. From the scholars that strengthened it is Ibn Abdul Hadi, rahimahullah, Al-Imam Al-Hakim, Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi, Ibn Hibban, Al-Nawawi, Ibn Hajar, Al-Shiqq Al-Albani, and Ibn Rajab Al-Hanbali. They all authenticated it. Because the hadith يقوي بعضها بعضا, that this hadith strengthens one another. If that's the case then, that if a person does something unintentionally, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will not place a sin on him, and he will not gain a sin from it. That's the first part. وَالْخَطَأُ وَالْإِكْرَاهُ وَالنِّسْيَانُ أَسْقَطَهُ مَعْبُودٍ الرَّحْمَانُ Allah has uplifted it from the person's shoulders. Nothing is held against him. But the second part of the bait is a question. لَكِنْ مَعَ اتِلَافِ يَثْبُتُ الْبَدَلُ وَيَنْتَفِي التَّأْثِيمُ عَنْهُ وَالزَّلَلُ Which is what? If a person, sin won't come to him, then is there عليه الضمان or لا يترتب عليه الضمان? Can he be questioned for the thing that he done unintentionally? He didn't intend to do it. He did something unintentionally. Can he be requested for the consequences of his actions? Can he be asked for it and said, "You're not. There's no sin on you, inshallah ta'ala. Allah is going to hold you account because ayah Rabbana la tu'akhidhna inna sina aw akhta'na." And Allah said, "Qad fa'alt." We agree that Allah is not going to hold you account for it, inshallah. But the question is, "Akhi, you hit my car with another car." Can the person say, "I want my rights from this"? The scholars, they say, "Inna al-khata kana fi huquq al-makhluqin." If it's because of a person, a creation, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَخْلُو مِنْ حَالَيْنِ It cannot get out of these two situations. It's either one of these two scenarios. The first scenario is, أَنْ يَكُونَ مَأْذُونًا لَهُ فِي أَصْلِ الْفِعْلِ فَيَقْصِدَهُ لَكِنْ يَقَعُ الْخَطَأُ فِي التَّقْدِيرِ The person is fully permitted. He's been given permission to do this thing. You gave him permission. In the original essence of this action, you had permitted him to do it. But a shortcoming, an unintended action occurred from him, or an unintended consequences occurred from something he didn't intend in that particular way. For example, a doctor, he did something wrong. The scholars, they say, he doesn't have to pay. There's no daman on him. Whatever shortcomings he does. The second one is, أَلَّا يَكُونَ مَأْذُونًا لَهُ فِي الْفِعْلِ No one's given him permission for the action. He wasn't permitted. فَوَلَا يَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهِ الضَّمَانِ He's going to be asked. Yeah, he's going to be asked for whatever he's caused and whatever came out of his action. So anyone, فَمَنْ أَخْطَأَ فَأَتْلَفَ غَيْرَهُ Anyone who done an unintentional action and he took somebody, he destroyed their wealth. وَجَبَ عَلَيْهِ الضَّمَانُ قَوْلًا وَاحِدًا Scholars, one speech, they all said that he has to give back what he destroyed. So nobody permitted for him to take the car. He just took the car with his own mind. He drove it. He broke up the car. It's عليه الضمان. وَلِذَلِكَ وَجَبَتِ الدِّيَةُ عَلَى الْمُخْطِئِ وَوَجَبَ الضَّمَانُ الْأَمْوَالِ عَلَى مَنْ أَتْلَفَهَا مُخْطِئًا بِالْإِجْمَعِ And if he killed somebody, there's diya involved. Diya means he has to give the blood money. And the wealth in which he destroyed, he has to bring it back. Bil ijma' consents. There's no khilaf on that one. Amma in kana as for if the mistake that a person did and the shortcoming, it occurred in the rights of Allah. فَحِيدَ إِذِ لَا يَجِبُ الْحَدِ There's no capital punishment. Nope. But the question is, هَلْ يَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ الضَّمَانِ Does he have to pay for the consequences of what he done? If it's Allah's rights, not a creation's rights. We say, لَا يَخْلُو الْحَالُ مِنْ أَمْرَيْنِ Again, it comes back to two situations. We've spoken about the creation, now we're talking about the creator. Two situations. The first one is, إِلَّمْ يُوجَدْ إِتْلَافُ فَإِنَّهُ لَا تَجِبُ كَفَارَةٌ أَوْ ضَمَانٌ بِقَوْلِ أَكْثَرِ الْفُقَهَاءِ إِلَّمْ يُوجَدْ إِتْلَافٌ If no destruction is occurred from his action, there's no destruction. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَجِبُ كَفَارَةٌ There's no expiation on him that he has to pay. أَوْ ضَمَانٌ Or there's no, he doesn't have to bring back anything. And that's the view of the majority of the scholars. And in the example, it becomes clear. For example, مَنْ غَطَّى رَأْسَهُ A person who what? Who places a cloth over his head. And he's in a state of what? وَوَ مُحْرِمْ He's in a state of ihram. And when you're in a state of ihram, you're not allowed to put anything on your head. He did it out of what? He did it out of forgetfulness or by accident. فَلَا كَفَارَةَ عَلَيْهِ Unintentionally, he placed it over his head. فَلَا كَفَارَةَ عَلَيْهِ There's no expiation on him. وَكَذَلِكَ مَنْ لَبِسَ الْمَخِيطِ خَطَأً لَا كَفَارَ عَلَيْهِ Or a person who wears clothing in the state of ihram, he puts trousers on, There's nothing on him. Good. Because there's nothing that's destroyed on the way. But حقوق of Allah إذا كان في إتلاف, something goes, something is taken out, something is destroyed, something you got rid of. For example, مثل قص الأظافر للمحرم, a person cut his nails, he got rid of his nails, he got rid of something, he took something. What did he take now? His nails off himself. Or he took his hair whilst in a state of ihram. Or he killed and hunted an animal whilst he was in a state of ihram. The scholars, they disputed this one. فَهَلْ عَلَيْهِ الضَّمَانِ. Is there a dhaman on him because of the nails that he took? Or the hair that he cut? Is there something required from him? عَلَى قَوْلَيْنِ. There are two views. The first view, they said, لَا يَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ الضَّمَانِ. There is no dhaman on him. And our evidence for that is, Allah said in the ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْتُلُوا الصَّيْدَ وَأَنْتُمْ حُرُمٌ وَمَنْ قَتَلَهُ مِنْكُمْ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاءُ مِثْلُ مَا قَتَلَ مِنَ النِّعَمِ فَجَزَاءُ مِثْلُ مَا قَتَلَ مِنَ النَّعَمِ. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he said in the ayah, all those of you who believe, do not hunt whilst you're in a state of ihram. Then Allah said, whoever kills amongst you deliberately, so underline the word deliberately. Then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he said, فَجَزَاءُ مِثْلُ مَا قَتَلَ مِنَ النَّعَمِ. Upon him is what? He has to bring the example of that which he hunted. So Allah conditioned deliberately. So they said this shows that if he does it by accident, there's no dhaman on him. There's no dhaman because Allah only, and they understood that from the mafhum al-mukhalafa. This is called dalalatu mafhum al-mukhalafa. The second view they said, بِأَنَّهُ يَجِبُ عَلَى الْمُخْطِئِ فِي حَقِّ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, that it's upon the person who does something unintentionally, even if it's the rights of Allah, إِذَا تَرَتَّبَ عَلَى خَطَّهِ إِتْلَافُ الضَّمَانِ. That is, if he takes and he gets rid of something, there's a dhaman on him and there's a kafara. And they used many evidences. And the evidences that they used was the speech of Allah, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ مُؤْمِنًا, anyone who kills a believer, خَطَأً, by accident. فَتَحْرِيرُ رَقَبَةٍ مُؤْمِنًا, upon him is what? Is free the neck of a believing slave. Ah, he has to take it. So, قَالُوا, they said, أَوْجَبَ الْكَفَارَةَ مَعَ كَوْنِهِ خَطَأً. Allah obliged upon him kafara, even that though it was by what? By mistake. Allah conditioned it on him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the evidence that was used by that party. That is what they used. The other one is the khata, and the ikrah. The ikrah is what? Ikrah means hamlul insani ala ma la yuriduhu wa la yarghabuh. Ikrah means is to take a person to something he doesn't want or he has no passion for. You make him do something he doesn't want. He has no passion, he doesn't want to do it, and you're making him do it. The scholars, they say, wal ikrahu ala naw'ain. The karaha, to put a person under duress, is two types. The first type is ikrah yazulu ma'hu al-ikhtiyar bil kulliya wa tantafi al-irada. It is a person who the karaha, it removes the karaha, as I said, is to force somebody to do something in which he has no want or no, he doesn't want to do it aslan. So it's of two types. The first one is that the person doesn't want it at all, and his choice, he doesn't want it at all. He doesn't want it at all. But his choice is fully taken from him. Fully. His want is fully removed from him. Na'am. That is the first one. That is the first type. The scholars, they brought an ijma', they brought a necessity, they brought a consensus that أن التكليف يزول بهذا النوع, that person, the takleef is uplifted from him under that situation. The second one is إكراهٌ, a person is under duress. يبقى معه الاختيار, he still has a choice in this issue. For example, the one who is being given a what? He's being told that he will be killed. كمن هدد بالقتل, they told him, oh, we're going to kill you. Or they're going to cut his limb. Or they're going to prison him. Or they're going to beat him up. The jumhur, they call this ikrahan ghayra malja'in. It's a duress But the person has still a form of a choice. The person said, if you don't do this, I will kill you. And you see, and he's not got you right now. You can go and you can come back. Na'am. Good. The Jumhur of Ahlul Ilmi, they say, this one, لا يزول به تكليف. The تكليف is not removed with this type. Because you have a choice still present. He's able to leave off something and he's able not to do it. Na'am. Very good. The third one that the author mentions, which is وَالْخَطَأُ and then إِكْرَاءُ and then nisyan. The nisyan is when a person forgets something. Nisyan means الْغَفْلَةُ عَمَّا كَانَ يَسْتَحْذِرُهُ الْإِنسَانِ. Nisyan is to be heedless of something that was in the mind of the person. You forgot something that was there, you became heedless of it. Nisyan, forgetting something, يَسْقُطُ بِهِ الْفِعْلِ وَيَسْقُطُ بِهِ التَأْثِيمِ. The action is uplifted from you and also the sin is uplifted from you. You're not sinning. Na'am. The person is not sinning. إِذَا تَرَكَ شَيْئًا نَاسِيًا أَوْ فَعَلَ شَيْئًا نَاسِيًا. If somebody does something because he forgot, he won't be held account for it. You see? And if he does something that is impermissible, out of forgetfulness, he will also not be held account for it. وَأَمَّا إِنْ كَانَ نَاسِيًا مُتَعَلِقًا بِحُقُوقِ الْخَلْقِ وَجَبَ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ ضَمَانُ مَا أَتْلَفَهُ. Again, but if he does something out of forgetfulness and it's attached to a human being's right, then it's obligatory on that person to bring back whatever he's caused. He still has to pay back. The fact that you forgot it, only what? So if you, for example, a person gave you a piece of meat and he said to you, I can cook this meat for me. You see, and you went and you burnt the food. Huh? You burnt the food. Then this person, the forgetfulness that you come with, you have to pay back itlaf for it. Very good. وَمِنْ مَسَائِلِ الْأَحْكَامِ فِي التَّبَعِ يَثْبُتُ لَا إِذَا اسْتَقَلَّ فَوَقَعَ. The author now, he's talking about issue called تَبَع, مَسَائِلُ التَّبَعِيَّةِ. The masail of the Sharia are of types. There are masail which they stand by themselves. They can stand alone. Some things they can stand istiqlalan, by itself. And another one, it can't stand by itself, something else is attached to it. For example, you want to sell an animal. The animal, you can't sell it because it's a pregnant animal. It has another animal in it. You're not allowed to sell it separately. You can't. This is called, it takes the ruling of what? Even the slaughtering, it takes the same ruling as his mother. So if you slaughter the mother and the animal falls out after the mother, it's allowed to be eaten. Because his dhabiha, his slaughtering, is what? Is with the slaughter of his mother. This is hukm al-tabi'iyya. It takes the hukm with his mother. It's tabi'u li-ummihi. It's with his mother. Okay? And the evidence for this qa'ida is the statement of Allah, أَوِ التَّابِعِينَ غَيْرِ غَيْرِ أُولِي الْإِرْبَةِ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ Surah An-Nur, Ayah 31. So the ulama, they bring under this one qawa'id and principles that are a lot that we'll speak about inshallah in Fara'id Al-Bahiyya. Inshallah ta'ala, in more details inshallah. So the person is not allowed to sell that sheep or that goat by itself separately. Say the mom, I'm going to sell it separately and I'm going to send the child separately. La, they both are what? They are both together in terms of ruling. So whatever you're going to do, you have to sell it together. Na'am. وَالْعُرْفُ مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ إِذَا وَرَدْ حُكْمٌ مِّنَ الشَّرْعِ الشَّرِيفِ لَمْ يُحَدْ. Here is the last قَاعِدَةُ الْخَمْسَةِ الْكُبْرَى. This is the last one. The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he spoke about the first one, which is in al-amalu bil-niyyat. He also spoke about al-yaqinu la yazulu bil-shak. We spoke about al-mashaqqatu tajlibu al-taysir. We also spoke about dararu yuzalu. And now this is wa'adatun muhakkama. Now we're going to move on to al-i'malu al-urf, which is al-'ada muhakkama. The custom is implemented. The custom of the people are taken on board. And it is considered. It is given some form of importance. وَالْعُرْفُ مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ إِذَا وَرَدْ حُكْمٌ مِّنَ الشَّرْعِ الشَّرِيفِ لَمْ يُحَدْ. The urf is implemented if it comes. If it comes a ruling from the Sharia, but the Sharia لَمْ يُحَدْ. The Sharia didn't define it. The Sharia didn't mention to us what the definition of this is. Then, and at that moment, what do? We take it back to the what? We take it back to the urf, the custom. The word urf, in the linguistic meaning, it means at-tatabu'u wal-dhuhuri wal-itmi'inan. It means something to become, follow one another, it to become apparent, and for it to be tranquil. لذلك يقال, because of that it said, تعارف الناس على كذا, أي تتابعوا علي. The people, تعارف الناس على كذا, the people followed each other up on this. That's why it's called custom. Generations after generations, they've been following each other up on this. That's why it's called عرف. نعم. اصطلاحا, technically it means, مطمأنت إليه النفوس وتتابعت عليه وذلك لأن العرف منه ما هو مشروع ومنه ما يقع مخالفا للشرع. It means what? Technically, مطمأنت إليه النفوس, that which the heart finds tranquility regarding it. وتتابعت عليه, and they follow each other upon. You remember when somebody tells you something and another group of people tell you it and another group of people tell you it and another group of people tell you it, it gives your heart tranquility and it becomes نعم, it gives you that. And also the عرف is categorized into two. عرف, which is that which is legislated, and that which goes against the Sharia. The عرف, those that go against the Sharia, and those which are not against the Sharia. And to implement the custom, evidences have stood up for this. قَدْ قَامَتْ عَلَيْهِ أَدِلَّةٌ عَدِيدَةٌ مِنْهَا. Many evidences. أن الشريعة أطانت بالعرف كثيرا من الأحكام. قال تعالى, Allah says, وعلى المولود لهن وعلى المولود له رزقهن وكسوتهن بالمعروف. Allah says, the children that are born, they have over their father, upon him what? رزقهن, their food, وكسوتهن, their clothing. Allah said, بالمعروف, in good. You see, Allah تبارك وتعالى also says, وعلى الموسع قدر وعلى المقتر قدر متاعا بالمعروف. Allah also says, وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا فَلْيَأْكُلْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. So Allah didn't give the one who's looking after the orphans a amount that he's allowed to take from the orphan money that he has. Allah only said to him, وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا. And he's poor. He's looking after an orphan, her parents have died. He's the one who's taking care of the orphan. Allah said to him, وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا. The one who is poor, فَلْيَأْكُلْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Eat that which is ma'roof. How do you know, how do you determine what is ma'roof? Again, it goes back to the custom. Also, Hinda radiallahu ta'ala anha, she complained about her husband Abu Sufyan. She complained about him. And she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said, Ya Rasulullah, my husband is shahih, he's stingy. Faqala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger said to her in reply, regarding the money that he doesn't give, she said, the Prophet said to him, خُذِي مَا يَكْفِيكَ وَوَلَدُكَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Take from him, that which suffices you, take from you that which suffices you and your children with good. بالمعروف. Then, those evidences, they all show that this it backs up this qa'idah. وَالْعُرْفُ لَا بُدَّ لَهُ مِنْ شُرُوطٍ حَتَّى نُعْمِلُهُ. It's important that these conditions are met for the urf in order for us to say that this urf can be implemented. وَشُرُوطُ الْعُرْفِ أَرْبَعَةُ شُرُوطٍ. There are four conditions. When these four conditions are mentioned, are found, then and only are we allowed to copy or do that custom. We're allowed to. The first one is, أن يكون العرف مضطردا غالبا بحيث لا يكون مضطربا فالعرف مضطرد على إطلاق لفظ الريال على السعودي أما لفظ الجنيه فمرة يطلق على المصري ومرة يطلق على الإسترليني. The عرف has to be something that is, whenever it's said, it's always meant by that, nothing else. So it can't be sometimes that it's there and sometimes it falls there. For example, the word riyal, when you say, the riyal, when you say, it's something that falls on what? The riyal falls straight on Saudi Arabia currency. But for example, if you say junay right now, in English you say pounds. Pounds can be more than English pound, British sterling. It can also be Egyptian. Egyptian, their currency is called pound. British is called the British sterling. And they're called Egyptian pound. So that urf, it's not. Naam. The urfia is problem. The scholars, they don't call that urf. They don't call that a custom. Because that's not known for a particular group of people in which they followed each other upon this. So they have another qa'idah for that one. Al-ibrata lil-ghalib al-sha'i' duna al-nadiri. They say that the consideration is put towards what is common not what is rare. And this is very important, because sometimes a person can do a nadhar and say, I promise I'm going to pay a pound. And when he thinks, he says, oh, Egyptian pound. And how are we going to implement this urf? It's important. Na'am. Then the second one is, أن يكون العرف غير مخالف للشريعة. That this urf, this custom, is not allowed to be in opposition to the sharia. فالمخالف للشريعة لا عبرة له. If it goes against the sharia, it has no weight. We don't implement it. For example, if it's from the custom of the people that they build their houses in a way in which that the house is open, the veil, the curtains are not placed there, you know, the women are seen inside, then this goes against the custom of the, this goes against the custom of the sharia. It is not looked into. It is not looked into. ثُمَّ لَا يُلْتَفَتُ إِلَيْهِ وَلَا تُقَيِّدْ بِهِ الْعُقُودِ. It is not looked at. Contracts are not based on it. And also, nowadays, the custom of the issue of isbal, your garment being below your ankles, this is a custom that goes against the sharia of Islam. It has no weight, we don't implement it. Number three, that the custom, أن يكون العرف السابقا غير لاحق, that the custom preceded and not something that came later. The fourth one is أَلَّا يُوجَدَ تَصْرِيحٌ يُخَالِفُ الْعُرْفِ. There shouldn't be something apparent that opposes that custom. It shouldn't be. And those, inshallah ta'ala, we will speak about it in more details, inshallah ta'ala. Mm-hmm.